Now, insects can damage trees in a number of different ways. One of the ways that insects can damage trees is by chewing. Most of us have probably seen leaves such as this on an oak tree, where you have lots of little holes where something has been chewing away and feeding. And here, you can see even more severe chewing damage all the way down to the stem of that leaf. The types of insects that cause this damage are ones with chewing mouth parts, such as gypsy moth. That's probably one a lot of people are familiar with. Japanese beetle is another one that we often see in the summertime, coming to our roses in particular. Now, there are different amounts of damage that chewing insects can do. If a tree gets a small amount, such as this, it's likely to recover, especially if it's early in the season. However, in the case of gypsy moth, for example, they can completely defoliate a tree early in the season. Now, that may not kill a healthy tree, but repeated defoliations over time, and sometimes multiple defoliations within a year, can actually bring down a perfectly healthy large tree. So this is one of the types of damage to look out for. It doesn't mean death for your tree, but it does indicate something's chewing on your leaves. So another way that insects can damage plants is by mining between the leaves. What this means is basically between the top layer of the leaf and the bottom layer of the leaf, they're actually inside and feeding. This can make them very difficult to control. For example, here we have a boxwood, and a common pest on boxwood is the boxwood leafminer. And what you typically see on older growth is spots, such as these yellowing spots. You will also see even more distinct brown spots on the foliage that indicate that something has been there. If you were to actually break open the leaf, you would find little yellow boxwood leafminer larvae. And they continue to feed until early spring, in which the female then flies out, they mate, and start the process all over again. Now, how is this going to hurt our plants, our shrubs, our trees? Well, what they're doing is they're eating chlorophyll, which the trees use to help make sugars to store in the roots to keep them strong throughout the winter and to protect themselves from other insects. So even though the damage across the whole plant is not really something that would catch your eye normally, it might be something you would want to control in order to keep your plant as healthy as possible. So another pest that gets on boxwood is one that feeds in a different way. It's called a spider mite, and actually it's not an insect. It's an arachnid, more closely related to spiders than to insects. And how they feed is by going on the underside of the leaf and actually sucking the chlorophyll out of individual cells on a leaf. Well, what effect does this have on the plant? If you look closely here, it causes a damage we call stippling or bronzing. You could see on these leaves where they look almost polka dotted because they've had chlorophyll sucked out of individual cells on them. If I hold up a healthy leaf, you can see the massive color difference in the two samples. So the plant then, if it's having chlorophyll sucked out of all of its leaves, is probably struggling to make as much photosynthate as it possibly could. So controlling spider mites is very important to keeping your plants healthy. They are something that can slip up on you really quickly if you don't look for them fairly frequently, and they can explode to really high numbers very quickly. So controlling them if you start to see this damage is a good idea. Well, what we've got here is a very unhappy looking katsura tree. In fact, it's so unhappy, it's dead. And the cause of death of this tree is a very, very, very tiny little insect called an ambrosia beetle. Now, how the ambrosia beetle actually kills this tree is by bringing in a fungus that it grows to help feed the developing larvae. The beetle itself is not chewing so much that it causes an issue. This fungus begins to grow and then clog up the vascular tissue of the plant. So how do we know that we have an ambrosia beetle? Well, if we look really closely at this plant, you'll see very, very fine point size holes coming out of the plant, as well as some sap and a little bit of frass. Is some of the insect waste sometimes will be sticking out. They call them a frass toothpick. So if we start looking closer, we'll see numerous ones of these little holes all over the plant. And if we were to cut this tree down and look at the inside of it, you'll actually see a staining inside of the plant where this fungus has grown. Now, there's not much that you can do once you have an ambrosia beetle inside the tree. That fungus is going to continue to grow, and it doesn't matter if you put an insecticide on the tree or in the tree, it's still, the tree is likely to die because of that fungal growth. Now, what I could have done to protect this tree, because it's a newly planted one, is realize that it is in a vulnerable state. So if you plant trees and that first year, you really want to keep an eye on them in that beginning part of the spring to make sure that they don't get an ambrosia beetle attack. One thing that you can do is protect the outside of the plant, usually with a bark treatment or a bark spray. And that keeps the ambrosia beetles out of your plants and keeps them alive. This is one of those pests that I like to call killing pests. It just takes a few of them that cause the death of the plant. Unlike things like caterpillars, which can kill, but it takes a lot more of them, and it takes repeated vigor-reducing activities of those pests to actually kill the plant. But this one, you've got to be on the watch out for and treat preventatively to keep your plant from being harmed. Now, once you have Asian ambrosia beetle in your tree and the vascular system is clogged and the tree is to this point with no leaves, there's not really any other treatment option other than what we affectionately term basal pruning. And here you can see that staining due to the fungus that the beetle brings into the plant. Another way that pests can damage trees is by sucking out the juices from the vascular system. This is the phloem and the xylem that carries sugars and waters throughout the plant. If an insect sucks enough of these juices out, it can severely weaken the tree over time and make it more susceptible to other pests, such as boring insects or bark beetles. So a specific kind of sucking insect is a scale insect. These are probably the most challenging to control in the landscape. One thing that makes them so challenging is it's really hard to see them, and you may not even know that they're there. For example, we're standing here underneath a maple tree that is infested with gloomy scale. Now, gloomy scale is a minute little scale that has mouth parts like a straw, sucking juices out of the tissues of this tree. And when you first notice it, you'll notice it as small, pepper-like specks of black marks. As the infestation gets larger, it will expand up into completely covering the trunk of a tree. All the way up into this plant, this silver bark is now blackened because of all of these scale insects on there. Now, what makes scale insects so challenging, besides just not even knowing they're there or wanting to find out when they're there, is that they create this covering over themselves that is pretty much repellent to any pesticides you might try to spray on it. However, if we know our pest, we have to know what the vulnerable stage is of that pest. And we do know for scale insects that the eggs are laid underneath that cover, and once they hatch out, they have little moving nymphs called crawlers. And these crawlers are very vulnerable. They don't have the cover over them and they're moving around, so they are very much more easy to control than the adults would be. So timing your scale applications is critical in order to get good control. And knowing exactly what species you have to know when to expect those crawlers to come out is also a very important factor. Now, scale insects are insects that feed on the phloem or the xylem of plants. There's so many different varieties, hundreds of different varieties associated with specific plants, which is another reason it makes it kind of difficult to manage these. You can see just here, I have two examples of scale insects. One is a soft scale on yew, and here we have a Fletcher scale on this evergreen plant. The Fletcher scale looks a bit like a big lady beetle almost, just kind of stuck solitary in place. And they can build up to large populations. Same with this soft scale here. These white fuzzy growths are actually scale insects, and underneath are the eggs that will hatch into hundreds of thousands of little crawlers that then will settle down and start sucking the life out of your plants. So there are several different ways that you can control scale insects. One of my preferred ways is actually to use something called horticultural oil. Now this isn't the vegetable oil that you would find in your pantry at home. This is actually a special distilled oil that you can buy with the name horticultural oil. It does not do damage to the plant leaves, although there are some precautions with certain plants, so reading the label is always important. But how this product works is when the scale have hatched out and you have crawlers on the plants, it actually smothers the crawlers without harming the beneficial insects on the tree. So you are getting control of your pest and preserving the good guys to keep the populations low in the future. Now, another way that you can control scale, however, is to use a systemic pesticide. These can be applied at certain times of year around the base of a tree or by injection, and you would want to be sure of what your pest scale insect is and the product, but that is another way. One more way is just a general broad-spectrum pesticide spray onto the tree. This is the least favored option, because it tends to kill off beneficial insects and lead to increases in numbers of spider mites often and bigger populations of scale in the future. So there are a lot of options depending on your situation, and you just have to find the one that works best for you.